Amatka is about surviving in a world where language controls reality. And it takes place in a colony that has been populated by humans, colonized by humans a while ago. And it's about what happens to a society that tries to survive in a world that's constantly threatening to collapse. And it's about the power of language, the power of love, and the question of what price are you willing to pay for a society to survive? And what price are you willing to pay to stage a revolution? Vanya is she's a researcher for a hygiene company. She comes to Amatka in order to research hygiene habits. It's not a job that she likes. It's just a job that she takes because she's supposed to do it. And Vanya is sort of, she's a failed citizen. She has failed to meet the requirements of a good citizen of these colonies. And I found that very interesting because in this society where everything is very controlled, where everything is decided, where everyone is brought up to think the same, to talk the same, to do the same things, I needed someone who could upset the balance to create a story, because I was interested in what would happen if someone started going against the order of this society, what would happen in the clash between this person and the society. Vanya sort of came to me on her own. I almost never control the characters. I just let them come to life on their own. So this is what she decided to do. I put her in the story and she started walking around and doing things. And she gradually started to want to do other things. So I just let her do it. It's part of how I work when I write is that I let loose of my control on the story. I just let the story happen as it wants to. So you could say I am a slave to my own story. I didn't write it to be a political book, but I think that probably everything I write is political by nature, but I think everything everyone does is political. We consist of politics. We cannot move in a vacuum. Everything you do has significance. So of course what I write is political, but so is everyone else's writings as well. I have never heard someone ask a writer, why are there so many men in your book? Never. But I get the question, is this a woman's book? Why are there so many women? Which I find very interesting, because it proves that the man is the norm. The man is the normal state of being. And if there are many women, there must be something political about it. It must be special. And I honestly didn't think about it when I wrote it. These are the characters that popped up, and I find it very interesting that people are reacting to the fact that so many characters are women, because they wouldn't have reacted if it were otherwise, the other way around. I actually grew up with French science fiction comics, which might be fun for you to know, like Valerian, Metal Hurlant, and Enki Bilal, and Jodorowsky, I think, also. There was a lot of French science fiction going on when I was a kid. So I think that probably left marks on me in a good way. But I've read a lot of things, from science fiction to fantasy to magical realism to social realist fiction. But what I like to focus on when I read is not specific writers, but a specific way of thinking about literature, which is thought experiments. What if a society looked like this? What if humans behaved like this instead of how they do in our world? So I think it's difficult to talk about influences, because I don't know who I've been influenced by. It's something that literary critics often tell me afterwards, that you have been influenced by this and this and this. And it's hard for me to say, because I read a lot and I watch a lot of films, and I read comics, and I listen to music, so it comes from all of these. But what I like to read when I do read is anthropological and feminist science fiction, for example. Authors such as Ursula Le Guin, She's one of my absolute favorites. Also Joanna Russ and James Tiptree Jr. And then you have influences like Tove Jansson, who is a Finnish artist and who really wrote books that are supposed to be for kids, but that you can read as an adult as well, because the themes are very existential, very dark. And then you have Swedish magical realist authors like Torgny Lindgren, who write about Sweden, but it's not quite Sweden. It's sort of a parallel reality Sweden where very strange things happen, which I think has influenced me as well. But the rest is sort of up to the critics to decide what they find in the books. The author that I have loved the most throughout my life, ever since I was a child, is Ursula Le Guin, because she writes about societies, she writes about humans and how they work, and she works with a lot of interesting themes. She works on questions of gender, of sexuality, of how families can look in different ways. I also read a lot of nonfiction, because I think if you're going to write fiction, you need to know something about the real world as well. So right now, for example, I'm reading about criminal women in the 1930s in Sweden, and stuff like that. So I started out writing in Swedish, and I did that up until about 2012. But the thing is that the science fiction community and the readers in Sweden are not so many, they're very few. And it's very difficult to get people who don't read science fiction. It's very difficult to get non-science fiction readers to actually read science fiction or fantasy, because science fiction and fantasy as genres are not very well respected in the mainstream, sadly. So I wanted to be read by more people, and I realized that maybe I could do this by translating my work into English, because I knew that there are lots of short story magazines, for example, where I could get published. And there was a possibility to reach a wider audience if I translated my work into English. So I wrote Amatka in Swedish and published that in Swedish in 2012. But I thought maybe it would also do better in English. And my Swedish publisher didn't market it to foreign agencies or anything, so I decided to do the job myself. But it's not really a choice that I made because I like writing in English. It's because I sort of had to, because I wanted people to read my work. So I still prefer writing in Swedish, but these days I don't do it that much, not when it comes to fiction. I usually, these days, write everything in English to start with, because I know that there's an audience. I know that someone will read my stuff, and it's also easier to get it translated into other languages. I teach writing workshops every now and then, not all the time, but I do workshops in writing fantasy and science fiction. And I trained as a teacher back in 2010, and I love doing it because it's extremely good for your own writing to teach writing, because it forces you to examine what you do, how does it actually work. It's like knowing how to work the engine of a car makes you a better driver, because you know what goes into the car. You know how to make things go faster or slower, as it were. And if you keep teaching at the same time as you're writing, it forces you to constantly develop your own skills. You can't go on autopilot anymore when you teach writing. It forces you to learn new things, and you also learn from your students. It's a very good way to get new angles on something, because a student will come along and they will do something crazy that you've never seen before. And they will show you a completely new side of writing fiction.